In our culture, it's almost impossible to spend a day without interacting with computers. Almost all of our work and communication is facilitated by computers, and we entertain ourselves by watching computers, often consuming content that is about computers. But despite our society's heavy reliance on them, it seems like relatively few people actually understand how computers work. Sure, most people have some vague understanding, but little knowledge of what's actually going on under the hood. In these videos, you'll be learning how to build a computer from first principles, building your knowledge of computer logic step by step. Starting from basic circuits and electronic building blocks, you'll eventually learn how to build an adding machine, a machine that works similarly to the CPU inside your computer today. To build this machine, we'll be using technology available as early as the 19th century. Today's electronic circuits are just miniaturized versions of the circuits we'll be constructing in this series. In this episode, we'll be starting from first steps, discovering logic gates, the very most basic components of digital systems. Let's imagine it's the 19th century, and the electrical telegraph is becoming all the rage. Enticed by the promise of instant communication, you decide you want to build a direct line to your friend in another city. So with a small loan of $1 million from your father, you get to work. Reading the latest books and manuals, you learn that a telegraph is just a single copper circuit including two main parts, a key and a sounder, as well as a power source to push a current through the circuit. Pressing down on the key completes the circuit and magnetizes a chunk of iron, attracting a metal bar, which makes a click and a clack when the key is pressed down and released. To save on copper, you just run the circuit one way from a power source, grounding it at the far end. But soon you figure out that there's a catch. The telegraph can only transmit signals so far. Roughly halfway between your city and your friends, you need to retransmit the signal. Rather than waste money paying someone to just copy the signals over, you take a spare sounder, a spare key, and attach a stick between the two, so that the whole thing conveniently takes care of itself. Closing the circuit on one end activates the device you've created, and retransmits the signal just like you've intended. The line works. Without knowing it, you've actually invented a critically important electronic device, the electromagnetic relay. You label the incoming signal from the key as input, and the outgoing signal to the sounder as output. After having simplified your design by replacing the bulky movable bar with a flexible strip of metal, you take to tinkering with relays in your lab and make some interesting discoveries. First, you find that you can use these relays for much more than just telegraphs. Connecting two relays together in this circuit so that the output of the first relay provides the input to the second relay, you observe that triggering the first relay instantly triggers the second relay, which outputs a current to light the light bulb. These relays, it seems, are switches that can be turned on and off by other switches. But soon you find more interesting ways that relays can be used together. When you connect two relays up in series so that the output of the first relay controls the power source of the second, you find that closing just one switch at a time is not enough to complete the circuit and light the bulb. Instead, you need to trigger both relays to allow a current to flow to the light bulb. When you connect the relays in parallel, they again behave differently. With this kind of circuit, the light bulb lights up as long as one or both of the relays are triggered. These kinds of circuits, which perform logical operations, are logic gates. You call the first circuit, for which both switches have to be closed for the light bulb to light up, an AND gate, which you represent by this D-shaped symbol, and you write up the different permutations of the circuits in tables, representing a voltage as 1 and no voltage as 0. The second circuit, for which either input needs to be 1 for the output to be 1, you call an OR gate, which is represented by this curved symbol. So now you have two interesting circuits you can make with telegraph relays, but you're not done yet. Tinkering with these parts in your study, you one day accidentally wire a relay up incorrectly, so that the relay outputs a voltage when it is untriggered, and outputs no voltage when it is triggered. You call this kind of relay an inverter, because its output is inverse to its input. Attaching this inverter at the output of an AND gate creates a new type of logic gate, which acts as the inverse to the AND gate. Here, the light bulb is lit unless both inputs are closed, at which point the inverter is triggered and breaks the circuit at the light bulb. Doing the same to an OR gate, likewise, inverts its output. Now the light bulb is only lit when neither the first nor the second inputs are 1. You name these two new gates not AND and not OR, or NAND and NOR for short. These four logic gates, AND, OR, NAND, and NOR, are the most basic building blocks of any digital system, like a computer. In different configurations, these gates can be used to add numbers together and store information in the form of computer memory. The computer you're using to watch this video on is built from hundreds of millions of tiny logic gates. Every computer you've ever used is essentially a clockwork device made from countless switches triggering other switches. In this video, we use telegraph relays to make logic gates, but as you may have guessed, modern computers do not use relays for logic gates. In fact, a logic gate can really be made using any switch that can turn other switches on and off. They're less electronic devices and more basic logical principles of the universe. You can use physical mechanisms to create logic gates, and early computers used vacuum tubes. The overwhelming majority of computers today use transistors for logic gates because of how light and cheap they are. In the next episode, you'll be figuring out binary and learning how computers count. After that, you'll learn how computers add and subtract, and finally how logic gates are used to create computer memory. At the end of this series, you'll know how to build a machine that can add and subtract two numbers together and save and load the result. This might seem like a basic goal to be reaching for, but this machine is essentially a simple version of a modern CPU. The core of every computer is essentially an extremely fast adding machine. And over the next couple of weeks, you're gonna learn how it works.